Less than a year ago, I celebrated what I thought was the election of a sceptical and liberal Conservative administration. And now I'm left wondering if the Prime Minister hasn't been abducted by Dr. Strangelove and reprogrammed by the sage over to the dark side. The purpose of politicians is to impose a measure of proportion, a sense of proportion on science, and not to be enthralled to it. Now, I will make myself very unpopular, but I believe that the appearance of the chiefs last week should have been a sacking offence. When they presented that graph, oh, with the caveat that it wasn't a prediction, but nevertheless, it was clear that they presented it as a plausible scenario, with its 50,000 cases per day by mid-October, based on the doubling of infections by the week. Not once, not on one day since March, have there been infections on that day that were double that of the day of the week preceding. Not once. Where did this doubling come from? What was their purpose in presenting such a graph? It was the purpose of the fat boy in Pickwick Papers. I wants to make your flesh creep. It was Project Fear. It was an attempt to terrify the British people, as if they haven't been terrified enough. Now, I've been banging on about this since March, and every criticism I've made, I've been told that the government was relying on the best possible science. So I am delighted by the letter 1 week ago today, the nuanced criticism of Professors Hennigan, Gupta and Sikora. And I believe that it is now the government that has to answer that criticism. I'm glad that the consensus in the scientific community is broken and the critics are speaking out. I don't underestimate for one moment the horrible nature of this disease and its post-viral syndrome. But in terms of the United Kingdom's killers, it is 24th in the league, accounting for only 1.4 of us. And as a consequence, I believe that the government's policy has been disproportionate. By decree, it has interfered in our private lives and our family lives, telling who we may meet, when we may meet them, and what we must wear when we meet them. We have the cruelty of elderly people in care homes, disoriented, being unable to see the faces of their loved ones and to receive a hug. We have the tsunami of deaths that we may experience shortly as a consequence of undiagnosed cancers and heart disease and the discontinuation of clinical trials. I give way to my right honourable friend.
Fenn looked at the advice given to the Swedish government and the different policies they followed, and what does he deduce from that?
I deduce that that was much more proportionate. Of course, all sorts of criticisms are levied against the Swedish government that on examination of the data and comparing like for like actually are without foundation. I certainly hold up the Swedish model as an alternative. We have seen the eye-watering costs that we must now all face for a generation, having closed down our economy for all those months as a consequence of the government's policy. The crushing of enterprises, the destruction of livelihoods, the unemployment that we're going to have to face now amongst young people, all as a consequence of an overreaction. I understand now there's some question as to whether students are to be allowed to return from university at Christmas. Can I say most gently to my honourable friend on the front bench that the last administration that sought to restrain celebrations at Christmas was during the Commonwealth, when the Lord Protector, as a consequence, was left musing in public as to whether, if he were to arm 1 in 10, that would be enough. how many marshals will be required. I conclude by saying that the policy of the government has been disproportionate in response to this threat. There may, Madam Deputy Speaker, be a virus one day that threatens our very way of life. But this isn't it, even if we're behaving as if it were.